somewhere in there taking me back, baby. This is Surround Sound Podcast. I am your man, Hunter Jr., the truth and not a rumor. I've been waiting on this day for, like, the beginning of the year. Nah. Since November, Black Friday, November 2015. Since last year. For almost 6 months, man. I've been waiting on this interview. I saw it then. I'm going to have my guy, Bryan Wilson, a Houston Teacher of the Year, man. This is going to be one of those seminal moments. I'm telling you right now. We might go viral. One time to Troy in the booth, man. We might go viral off of this one. Troy in there doing what he does with his magical fingers, man. I guess I need to really open the show. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. We're live from Music Row Studios, baby. Surround Sound Podcast. Make sure you go and like this. Make sure you go and like the fan page. I just posted some information pertaining to Eric Badu. And Eric Badu is one of those seminal characters in the landscape of R&B music, hip-hop music. She's one of those eclectic acts. Actually, she was talking about proper dress for younger girls in school. And it's crazy because on one hand, she was this artist that was like completely clothed. She had doobie wraps. I'm talking about like long dresses to the floor, you know, didn't show any body parts or whatever. And then, like, later on in her career, and I would say probably, what, like, an album ago or two albums ago, she did Window Seat video where she's completely nude through the video. Still one of my all-time favorites. That's neither here nor there. But what I'm saying is, her sexuality, she knows it, and she owns it. There, you can throw rocks and throw stones at her. It don't matter. You know what I'm saying? You really can't talk against her because she knows what she is. And that leads me directly to author Kendrick Patrice. We're going to finish up our discussion on the reevaluation of the African-American female. Solo Saturdays. Not this coming Saturday, which is like the 16th. Not this Saturday, but next Saturday. And we're going to re-engage that discussion that we had about 2 weeks ago. So if you might need to get familiar. So go back, Surround Sound Podcast, YouTube page. Go, listen, and then you'll be up to speed. We'll be back in just a second. My man, Brian Goose Wilson. In about 2 seconds. So you make sure you stay right there. Right now, Young Bloods. Chop, chop. Right here. Surround Sound Podcast, baby.
Chop, chop. Chop, chop. Yeah, I'm back on the block. On the block. Get like that shit them niggas cook up and rock. Cook up and rock. Just draw. Had to have it, went and got it out the line. Out the line. It's a central presidential like my green. Like my green. From Lipazine and Codeine, Nileen. Stay clean, mug, always mean. More mean. Still ride with the red bean team. Bean team. Still posted up, still same spot. Same spot. Shit working out the block, fire hot. Money getting made, niggas getting paid. Get paid. Niggas keepin' working, Chevys getting sprayed. Top, top.
Down south, hair bust a monster in this booth. I'm a hardcore, badass, a soldier from the back street. And tell motherfucker whoever try to cross me. Some call me J-Bo, others call me Herringbone. And you see, I'm a young blood. And these bitches, they won't leave me alone, right or wrong. You should know the difference, not to never speak. Now run and tell your mama and your daddy how your shit is weak. Been a deep, yeah, nigga, this ain't what you want in life. Or what you need, cause see your pressure wheel bust a pipe. Cause like tonight, ain't no doubt we blowing on that thing. That purple push, that pressure. This shit is what I mean.
Top. Yeah, I'm back on the block. Engine from another frame.
down fools out the attic stacking dividends. Atlanta, Georgia, out to get you, so don't be afraid. Just be around, watch your ass when you come to play. Maniacs off the wall, real niggas never fall. Pippin' by the day and through the week, and I'm gon' keep it raw. Put it tight, let them know there's plenty ways of making dough. It's all I buy, I smoke, and I got plenty more. Through the tall, stampeding like a pack of hungry wolves. Still keep it poppin', hoping, wish another nigga would. Backwoods, dirty south, don't make me bust you in the mouth. Don't make me act a fool and clear this whole damn place. Top.
And welcome back. It's All Hunter Jr., the truth and not a rumor. It's a Round Sound podcast. We're going to do the Funky 4 plus 1 mo. And we starts off in the PGA golf. We had the Masters this past weekend. I always like the Masters because, you know, it's always right around my birthday, man. So, and big shout out to Englishman Danny Willett. He won with a final round 67. I'm going to tell you this right now. If you don't know a lot about golf, the Masters is like the hardest thing. Like, you're trying to get as few strokes, so you want to have the lowest score possible. I see guys with like 4 unders and 3 unders, and they mess around like got like 70s on the course. So basically what I'm saying is it's really hard. Now, I know it's hard because Jordan Spieth, last year's winner, this dude must be really hot because he led the entire weekend and lost a 5-stroke lead with 9 holes to go. That is insane. That just lets you know how hard this course is. But once again, Englishman Danny Willett, big up to you, man. Enjoy that green jacket. MLB coverage. Once again, 4 teams. You know how we do. Chicago Cubs, Chicago White Sox, Atlanta Braves, and those Detroit Tigers. Well, my Cubs, we're 6-1, baby. We're red hot. And that one loss was to the Arizona Diamondbacks. We lost 3-2. Diamondbacks scored 2 runs in the 8th and 9th. And hey, so be it. We can't win them all. We got the second best record in the whole Major League Baseball, right behind those Baltimore Orioles. They're 6-0. Big shouts out to the Chicago White Sox. They're 5-2 and leading the AL Central also, which means the Detroit Tigers are right there behind those guys with a 4-2 record. Atlanta Braves, you guys are 0-6. You need to come on not quick, but real quick. I'm talking about 0-100, real quick, in Drake fashion. You know what I mean? Number 3. And this is probably the most important number 3 of any Funky 4 plus 1 mo ever. Big shout out to our new sponsor, Healthy Junk Food. One time to Montoya, I. Martin. It's going to be a lot of information about healthy junk food. And basically what it is, it says in the title, healthy junk food. You like popsicles, you like ice cream, you like cakes, you like pies, cookies, all fruity beverages, whatever you like. She's making it in a good way, healthy way. So I know as far as the African, not even just African-American culture, United States period, obesity is running rampant, diabetes, high blood pressure, strokes, all these type of things. Well, this is your way to keep those treats that you do like, but at the same time, eat healthy. Number 4, NHL news. Playoffs start this week, and those Preds will face the Anaheim Ducks. I'm going to tell you right now, it's going to be hard for the Preds because the Anaheim Ducks started like 1-7-2 or something crazy like that. They won like 1 game out of their like first 10. So, but at the same time, they righted the ship and now they're in the playoffs. So there's going to be one of those things where, hey, they have the momentum. Everybody has been, you know, casting us out and casting aspersions upon us. Now look where we're at. So it's going to be tough. But anytime we got Pekka, Stonewall, Rene in between the pipes, oh, yeah, we got a chance. So it's looking, I'll say it's looking good for the Preds. We're going to see what they do. And the one mo comes from this show. Stay tuned. We have a Houston Teacher of the Year, Bryan Wilson. We're going to get into education, sports, culture, and how all three of these things mesh together. We'll be back with more entertainment news on the Surround Sound Podcast. All Hunter Jr., baby. I'm getting choked up, y'all.
I don't know, dude. I think everybody's all jealous and shit, cause I'm like the lead singer of the band, dude. And I think everybody's got a fucking problem with me, dude. And they need to take it up with me after the show.
Because these chicks don't even know the name of my band, but they're all on me like they wanna.
So I get off stage, right? Drop the mic. Walk up to these hot chicks and I'm all like, what's up, ladies? My name's Slim Shady. I'm the lead singer of D12, baby. They're all like, oh my god, it's him. Becky, oh my fucking god, it's him. I swear to fucking god, dude, you fucking rock. Please, Marshall, please let me suck your cotton. And by now, the rest of the fellas get jealous. Especially when I drop the beat and do my acapellas. All the chicks start yelling. All the hot babes, all the bras and the shirts and the panties on stage. So like every single night they pick a fight with me. But when we fight, it's kinda like sibling rivalry. Cause they're back on stage the next night with me. Dude, I just think they're trying to steal the light from me. Yesterday, Canavi tried to pull a knife on me. Cause I told him Jessica Alba's my wife to be. This rock star shit is the life for me. And all the other guys just despise me because these chicks don't even know the name of my band. But they're all on me like they wanna hold hands. Cause once I blow, they know that I'll be the man. All because I'm the lead singer of my band.
My band, 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 my band.
See a nigga backwards, don't you? Hey, Dad, how come we don't rap off Pro Tools? Smash these vocals and do a performance. But we in a van and he in a tour bus. You don't want my autograph, you's a liar. Nah, I'm swell.
Oh, I thought you were conniving.
What the hell is wrong with that dressing room? Cause I should've looked smaller than a decimal. See, I know how to rap. It's simple, but all I did was read a Russell Simmons book. So I'm more intact, trying to get on the map, doing jumping jacks while getting whipped on my back.
Look at them little punk ass thinking he the shit.
Yeah, I know, man. By himself taking all the flicks.
Hey, I thought we had an interview with DJ Clue.
No, I had an interview, not you two.
You gonna be late. The sound check.
I ain't going to sound check.
When our mics is screwed
up. And his always sound best. You know what, man? I'm gonna say something.
Hey, yo, M.
You got something to say?
Man, no.
I thought you was about to tell him off, man. What's up?
Man, I'm gonna tell him what I feel like, it, man. Shut up. You ain't even back me up. We supposed to be cool.
Man, I'm about to talk right after you. I swear.
Man,
I swear, man.
These chicks don't even know the name of my band. But they're all on me like they want to hold hands. Cause once I blow, they know that I'll be the man. All because I'm the lead singer of my band.
They say the lead singer's rock. The group is not. With some sold out arenas to amusement parks. I'm gonna let the world know that proof is hot. I should cut his mic off when the music starts. Ready to snap on a dumbass fan every time I hit.
Hey, dude, I love your band.
We ain't a band, bitch. We don't play instruments. So I get 90 and we only get 10%. And these guys acting funny every area cold.
Proof game, I'm back.
Bitch, carry on. Can't make it to the stage. Security in my way.
God damn it, I'm sick of this group. Time for me to go solo and make some loot. I told you I made the beats, wrote all the raps, and took kind artists. Slip me some crack. Lose Yourself video, I was in the back. Superman video, I was in the back. For the media, I got some suggestions. Fuck Marshall, ask us some questions like who is D12, how we get started.
But what about Eminem?
Bitch, are you retarded? Anyway, I'm the poppers guy in the group. Big ass stomach, bitches think I'm cute. 50 told me do sit-ups to get buff. Did 2.5 and couldn't get up. Fuck D12, I'm out of this band. I'm about to start a group with the real Roxanne.
Girl, why can't you see your name? Only one for me, and it just tears my ass apart to know that you don't know my name.
Fuck it.
These chicks don't even know the name of my band. But they all on me like they wanna hold hands.
Fuck Marshall.
Cause once I blow, I know that I'll be the man.
Yeah.
All because I'm the new sweet.
Pretty girls want to dance my salsa. Ooh, 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 look out for my next single, it's called My Salsa. My Salsa, Salsa.
Yeah, boy! This is the Surround Sound Podcast, baby. Double play style. All
right, yo, for that nigga Green Latin, you know what I'm saying? G12. Huh? Big Proof. Representing the Shady Record family. Konami. Over Trice. 50 Cent.
Calling all this. You know what I mean? Busy.
Shout out to this, man. You know what I mean? D12 all day. And y'all niggas out there spitting the venoms and shit, right?
Detroit.
I ain't gotta say no name. Y'all can't even rap, you know what I'm saying? So I do my thing. Listen, listen. Hey, yo, let L lick his lips and M hate his mom. I'm the gangest kind of rap, dangerous on tracks. Can't a dish the whack weak, the plain garbage. I crave for respect, so don't act like I ain't starving.
I'm hungry.
You a pitiful whack rhymer. You a bitch nigga. Oh, you
get it from your mama. I bomb your armor to your limbs and branches off your tree Tims. Murk the world, no way we can be friends. Proof is nutty as semen. Believing anything breathing around a heathen must be rushed to receiving. Beast of young Zian, pace one, ain't none. Ready to spit fire, bitch, I'm a lace blunt. And what they lace me with, you can't replace the kid. My words be like surgery, making faces live. I'm a matrix glitch, call me deja vu. I deja crew, niggas know not to hate on proof, bitch. I'ma shoot at all y'all for fucking with my dogs. I'ma shoot at all y'all for fucking with my dogs. I'ma shoot at all y'all for fucking with my dogs. I'ma shoot at all y'all for fucking with my dogs.
See what I'm saying? Like that, D12, man. We can rhyme, we can spit. We can do whatever, you know what I'm saying? We can spit with the rhymes, we can spit with the lines, you know what I'm saying? Motherfuckers wanna rhyme. Motherfuckers wanna get in this little political game to boost they sales and retail, you know what I'm saying? We ain't into that shit, nigga. We doing this for life, nigga. We doing this shit for real. Think what you wanna think, let the purple pill shit confuse you. Don't think you can get popped outside popular music, nigga. You heard me? It's cause it go pop, don't mean the niggas don't pop, nigga. Sure. Don't get that Hollywood shit fucked up, cause you see niggas on TV all the time. And we do it bigger than y'all. Remember that though. We do.
Welcome back, guys. Surround Sound Podcast. I'm Al 100 Jr. The Truth and Not Way. We're gonna get into some entertainment news really fast, really quick and really fast, because we got my guy Bryan Wilson on the line. But we were coming back from some D12 featuring Eminem and a proof freestyle. Now, once again, this is April Music Month, and we're doing the top 25 artists like of my generation, I guess. Just not, I won't say all times, but since 1981, we're gonna do just like the top 25. Anyway, Eminem is one of those artists, and number two, Proof died this week in Detroit. So big shouts out to D12, Eminem, and rest in peace, Proof. Now, also in entertainment news, as far as birthdays go, it's a cavalcade of Aries babies. First, we're going to start off with Ty Dolla $ign, Peebo Bryson, David Letterman, Herbie Hancock. I pause, Herbie Hancock. It wasn't just a bad joke on my part. Ed O'Neill from Married with Children. Love that dude. I don't even know who this next chick is, but she fine as all outdoors. Model Flora Cockrell. I don't know who that is. She's African French, and I don't know. She's just fine. Look her up. I'm going to get down in her DM later on tonight. Anyway, also, the one and only, Al Green, his birthday is this week. Additionally, this just sounds like a joke, but Martin Lawrence, Charlie Chaplin, Pope Benedict XVI, and Akon all walk into a bar because it's their birthday. That's the start of that one. You fill it in however you need to do. Number two, J.J. Watt and Kate Hudson are apparently dating. All I got to say to JJ is tread lightly for two reasons. One, because the last time a prominent Texas professional football star was dating a high class, female, it was Tony Romo and Britney Spears. All I got to say is be careful, JJ Watt. And then number two, she dated A-Rod and Lance Armstrong. If there were ever two athletes more consumed with lying, I say it would be those two. I don't know if she just having bad luck. I don't know if that's just what she does. But I hope, JJ, you ain't the third one. Speaking of football, O3's company, it was weird because it was two girls and a guy that were roommates. Well, this comes from that same vein. Drake and Odell Beckham Jr. are now roomies. I don't get it. I don't know where it comes from. However, if you get on the Surround Sound Podcast fan page, and you'll be able to see and read the story for yourself. I'm trying not to pass any judgment. But I'll say this. Odell Beckham Jr. has been the target of a lot of, insensitive remarks about his sexuality and if he is or isn't. I don't care. What I will say is that I guess what Drake said was right in Summer Sweet 16. His pool must be really bigger than Kanye's. Anyway, lastly, from the music world, speaking of YMCMB, Lil Wayne. Lil Wayne is a tad emotional these days. This dude, he said he admits to crying after the dedication on the Collie Grove mixtape that he did with, Future. It's not Future. That he did with 2 Chainz. I guess he's just a little sensitive. Anyway, we'll be back on the Surround Sound Podcast. I am Al 100 Jr., the Truth and Not a Rumor. Bryan Wilson up next.
I'm hurting, baby. I'm broken down. I need your loving, loving. sweet. Don't let nobody touch it unless that somebody's me. I gotta be a man, there ain't no other way. Cause girl, you're hotter than a Southern California day. I don't wanna play no games, you don't gotta be afraid. Don't give me all that shy shit, no makeup on, that's my sugar.
Welcome back, Surround Sound Podcast, Al Hunter Jr., Truth and Not a Rumor. Before I bring this young man on, I just want to let you guys know, man, if you cannot understand this, I'm apologizing now. Our Memphis vernacular will show its head during this interview. Now, everybody west of Paris, Tennessee, and what, east of West Memphis and north of South Haven and south of Millington, they'll get it. However, if you're not, you may not. Once again, I've been waiting on this interview for a long time, since about Black Friday of 2015. This young man was one of my classmates. He's a Houston area teacher of the year, Bryan Wilson. What's going on, B?
What's going on? What's the deal, baby? You all right?
Hey, I'm doing fabulous, man. But we're going to go ahead and start it off, man. Tell us your history. Where are you from and what you do?
First and foremost, Memphis, Tennessee, the Haven, Haven High School graduate, Whitehaven, the neighborhood, Whitehaven, everything, born and bred.
That's right.
And when I'm gone, I'm going to be Whitehaven dead. That's where I'm from. I mean, I have deep roots in the Haven. Grandfather from the Haven, like, I'm old school with it.
Mm-hmm.
Education, went to Southern University, HBCU, love that place, love it with all my being. And as far as education, I'm a third generation educator.
Mm-hmm.
This is all I know. I remember my grandfather picking me up on a school bus. Like, picking me up from school on a school bus.
Uh-huh.
You know, that's something right there now. And, you know, everybody talk about you on that cheese bus. I'm getting picked up on a cheese bus, so you know that's a trip.
Uh-huh. I feel it. Yeah,
so, you know, that was interesting. But that was then. And where I am now, I taught in Memphis for a couple of years. Was a distinguished teacher there. Mm-hmm. Now I'm out here in Houston. Recognized a couple of times for Teacher of the Year.
Okay.
Organization. So I'm in a running right now for District Teacher of the Year. So I'm just trying to educate the kids.
That's really cool on two fronts. Not only have you won Teacher of the Year like a couple of times over, and you're going for the district now, but your bloodline is teaching. So who better to ask these questions that I'm about to pose to you?
Absolutely, I'm here, man. Look, this is what my family does. Like, everyone has their lot of life. This is mine. I've known for a long time. I even tried to fight it once before in college.
Uh-huh.
I did not want to be an educator. I was tutoring some of my line brothers, 858-1906. I was tutoring some of them. They were like, man, you a good educator. I was like, man, look, don't say too much. I don't want to be a teacher. I know what those hours look like.
Mm-hmm.
I know what those kids look like. I tried to stay away from it. It didn't work, as you see.
Mm-hmm. That's cool, man. My first
destiny.
My first question, Bryan. Everything I've looked at for the past, what, 5, 10, maybe 15 years, it says that the United States educational system is at the bottom. It's not that good. Our students are horrible as far as testing goes. It's trouble in the classrooms. What can we do to fix our educational system for African Americans in the United States?
Oh, man, that's a great question. Look, we have to make it a priority. First off, do we want to fix the system? Because you got to go back and look at how African Americans were brought into the system. African Americans were thrown upon the system, and African Americans were thought of as problems to the system. The system was already in place. African Americans came on later.
Mm-hmm.
So it wasn't like the system was made for African Americans. The system had to deal with African Americans after the system was already up and running. And the system never slowed down. Because you got to remember, from the beginning, African Americans are already behind the eight ball.
Mm-hmm.
Think about it. Back in the day, look, if you're a black man and they found out you could read, they either beat you or killed you.
True.
If they found you with a book, they killed you or beat you. So, I mean, so starting from there, you're already behind. So what is America going to do to close that gap? Because it wasn't just like it was some foreign people who were saying, man, I find you with a book, I'm going to kill you or do something to you. This is America.
Mm-hmm.
Of the country, the founding fathers of the country had slaves.
Right.
And didn't allow their slaves to read books. So if we want to fix the problem, first we got to recognize that we do have a problem. We got to start from the beginning and realize if you're going to raise something up, you don't pull from the top. You get down low in the mud and you pull from the bottom. And as you look at the system, African Americans and those people of color, Hispanics, are by the number statistics are at the bottom. So what are we going to do? Because if you look at the system, man, the people who had the money, they doing fine.
Right.
So when you ask about the problem of the system, it depends on what side of the fence you on. If you, you know, at the top, it's a great system because in this capitalistic society, it's about the people who have it are doing fine. The people who don't have it, trying to play catch up. But it's being stretched out when you try to pick up something from the bottom. Remember, some sort from the top. It's stretched out and it's squeezed in the middle.
Mm-hmm.
It's squeezed in the middle. And African Americans, we have to make decisions on our own too. We have to decide where our value is going to be placed. Because we have some distorted views in our community as well. We tell our kids, you can't go to the NBA. I don't tell my kids that. I tell my kids, man, you can go to the NBA. You can make it. Because you might not become the next LeBron James. You might be LeBron James' trainer, make six figures.
Mm.
And that's a good paying job. Be able to take care of yourself, take care of your family. You might be LeBron James, whatever. You may be his trainer. You may work at his gym. You may work for the NBA. You might be a power boy and making well enough where you don't have to do any crazy stuff in the street. You can take care of yourself, your family, your mama, whoever else.
I like that concept right there. That's dope right there because the thought is that if you don't, quote unquote, make it as an athlete actually playing the game, then you haven't made it to the NBA. But if you do anything with the NBA, yes, you have made it. You could be the camera guy. You could be the color commentator. You could be like me talking about the NBA. You can be somebody writing, passing programs. You can do a whole lot of stuff.
Man, you know what you do not want to be for a kid, you do not want to be a dream killer.
Right. You give the kid options.
You see a kid who 5'3", 230 pounds, and he say, look, I want to go to the NBA. You look at him, you say, work hard. That's all you tell him. Man. You don't tell him, man, you'll never make it. You tell him, work hard. You might not be in the NBA, but what if you end up coaching LeBron James? What if you end up being an assistant? What if you being in a gym attending, making a nice amount of money, and you get to watch the games of LeBron James play every night? Man, you done made it. That's a good paying job. You're doing well for yourself.
That is. Definitely so. Tell me this, though.
All right.
Tell me this. Could you hear me? Can you hear me?
Absolutely.
Okay. Tell me this. When you say the system dynamic, and you say that it's not meant to help everyone, what is that really talking about? Like, what syndrome is that? Is that like a square in a peg hole type of syndrome right there?
That's well put. That's well put. Look, it's a capitalistic society. Capital being money, resources. So you have the people who have all the resources. You have the people who are trying to acquire the resources. So it's the haves and the have-nots. The haves have everything they need to keep perpetuating their success.
Let me stop you right there. Okay. Do the haves have something like systematically that helps them replicate more than, you know, replicate success more than, you know, those that don't have it?
Yes. They have the system itself working in their favor. Think about this. When the system was made, who was the system made for? The system was not made for African-Americans. We weren't even a part of when the system was made. The system was not made for Hispanics. The system was not made for Asians. The system was not made for certain groups of people. I mean, because if you go back into the history, if you look at the Declaration of Independence, they took out a portion, the Declaration of Independence, that was going to outlaw and ban slavery. So they took that out so they can keep slavery going on. If you look at America's history, there were certain things done to certain groups of people that kept them in horrible situations. I could name off a couple. Giving the Native Americans blankets that had smallpox. African Americans took the experiment. The racism that the Asians faced when they came over looking for jobs and everything. These groups, they slot Now, there were other groups like the Irish that faced a lot too as well, but they didn't have to fight the system.
Mm-hmm.
Because in documents, you go back into the old documents, talk about free white males. You're a free white male, you Irish, you German, you coming over from all these countries, you're an immigrant, you coming into the country. The system is set up to work for you. Well, if you're not in that free white male, because they had defined exactly who the system will be working for, free white males. Well, if you outside that box, you got a problem on your hands. And as we evolve, we never address the beginning. We never address that seed. It started growing, it got too big, it grew out of control. It's like that old movie, Feed Me, Seymour. It got to a point where it was too big to control.
Mm-hmm.
The system was eating.
Little Shop of Horrors.
There you go. Look at it, babe. I see you with the movies.
Yeah. Although I don't watch a lot. But hey, I feel where you're coming from. Would you say that support system, would you say that is what helps Johnny Manziel do the things that he does?
Man, look at this. Come on, man. Manziel has done all this stuff, okay, with the Denver Broncos not too long ago. And he's still doing stuff.
Yeah, he's still out there wilding and partying.
And he's still wilding.
Yeah.
He get on the interview drunk, talk about he not drunk, but he's sounding drunk.
Yeah.
Man, come on. Who get that benefit of the doubt? Like, look at RG3. RG3 was arrogant. Mm-hmm. He refused to be humble. Man, was he doing this?
Nah.
Like, he got benched for a whole year because they didn't want to play him. They just didn't want him to get hurt, and they didn't want to pay the man. Like, come on. Like, he not doing this stuff, though. And Manziel is still out here looking for a job and probably and getting interviews. People wouldn't even touch RG3.
That's crazy. Tell me this. What do you think about the psychological makeup? Because I know as an African American, sometimes it's you get frowned upon trying to go to school. Just speak to that, because education is very important. But if in our if we're not valuing education, if our psychology is not valuing education, then you know, like, how can we get around it? How can we get around it?
Well, look at this, man. Look, why is education frowned upon in our community? For a number of reasons. Because we see people go to college, get degrees, multiple degrees, do better college, and they back in the hood right beside the dude that's not going to college. Like, you went to college, you put yourself in debt, you did all those years away from the neighborhood, and now you're right beside me. Like, why should I go to college?
Yeah.
Or you go to college, you get thousands of dollars in debt. I don't go to college. I'm not in debt, but I don't have your degree. Who is better off? That's a flip of the coin. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of crazy, because as an African American man, when you get that, you sold that dream, man. You go to school, African Americans are sold that white American dream. You go to college, you get out of college, you're gonna be fine. Everything gonna be all right.
Mm-hmm.
That's not the truth, African American.
Don't see the other side of it. Yeah.
Yeah. You go to college, you secure all this debt, and now you got to work just as hard before you went.
Mm-hmm.
You're still working, and before you can really see some of your money, you got to pay back. Elevate $40,000, $50,000, $60,000, $70,000.
Yeah.
And your people think you didn't made it because you went to college, not knowing, because they can't see the debt that's on your credit report. Mm. So it's kind of a double-edged sword. But what we have to start doing, we have to start empowering ourselves and empowering our HBCUs, because they're cheaper and it's the same degree. But we also have to start making jobs. Like, we can't expect to go to college, spend all this money for college, and come back and somebody to give us a job. And the system not set up like that, but we're not in Tallahassee system works, because I was just looking like last night on Facebook how Texas, where I am, is trying to get rid of slavery out the history books. Ain't that something?
Hmm. How you feel about that?
Taking slavery out. So it's interesting, because if you look at history, certain parts of history have been omitted already. Now I just get to see it firsthand, because I always wonder, now why is it from kindergarten to 12th grade, I got to talk about the same four or five African Americans?
Mm-hmm.
So many times I can hear about Martin Luther King, Harriet Tubman, Frederick Douglass, and it's like two or three other people that you hear from elementary school to high school. But then if you think about, what about the other groups that contributed to the greatness of the United States?
Mm-hmm.
We rarely talk about the Asians. We rarely talk about Native Americans. We rarely talk about Hispanics. But you tell me, man, this country is a couple hundred years old. You know, like four or five black people and the rest of white people. And then we don't talk about them in their full history. Like, we talk about the president, but we talk about what the president did, like, afterwards. Like, I was looking last night by Thomas Jefferson and his plantations on the back of the nickel, the Monticello nickel. But, like, Thomas Jefferson has black relatives, because he, you know, was raping his slaves. But we don't talk. That doesn't show up in the books we need to talk about both sides. Let's handle history even handedly.
Hold on right there. Hold on right there, because now where you're going is something that I want to talk about after the break, and that's where the future lies. Like, once we see the past and the present for what it is, how do we go further in the future? We'll be back in just a second. Bryan Wilson, All Hunter Jr., yeah. Surround Sound Podcast.
A little something for all the OGs out there that put the foundation together. I was doing this thing before I even knew what to do with this thing right here, you know? But just to let them know what time it is, how we get down. Me, cocaine, and Bout K. I'll let y'all know how we do this thing here. Check this out, y'all.
We stay on point like Stacey Adams.
24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Can you dig it? That's real talk, man. Right? You know what?
We stay on point like Stacey Adams.
That's real talk right there, baby.
Stacey Adams.
I'm in a three-piece suit, looking too cute. Mashing, flashing, looking for a prostitute. Boo boo, you got that loot? I'm watching you, you watching me. It's all to the gravy because it's VIP. And everything in here moving belong to me. The component set was given to me by a pimp buddy of mine, Disco D. He told Frisco E, this here gonna be the baddest pimp nigga that you ever gonna see. Colder than Fillmore Slim, tilt that brim, Snoop Dogg. Gonna sell that trim, keep it cracking like pistachios. Get that money and continue to mash these hoes. And when the players ball roll around again, I'm guaranteed to win. You know why? Cause
we stay on point like Stacey Adams.
24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Yeah, yeah.
Hell no.
You know why?
We stay on point like Stacey Adams.
You know, that's all we know how to do.
Stacey Adams.
G'd up from the feet up.
Welcome back to Surround Sound Podcast. Once again, we're in here with a dear friend of mine and of Surround Sound Media, Bryan Goosebig Wilson, man. Goose, let me ask you a question before we go right back into investing into the future. And this is kind of like a sports college-related question. And as you know, and our listeners know, Will Smith, he was shot in New Orleans. And those are your stomping grounds, your old stomping grounds. You know, Baton Rouge is a little ways from New Orleans, and then some things with two young ladies that I think it was at Louisiana State at LSU, and they were, but they were from Southern. Did I get that correct?
Yes, sir. At a party on that side of town.
Where do you see sports, violence, and education meshing? I know that's a broad question, but I just want you to swing at that thing.
Sports, man. Look, sports gives a lot of people, especially African American from our community, give a lot of people the opportunity to go to college. Mm-hmm. Some people who never even thought about going to college, mm-hmm. never thought about, never crossed their mind. Then the opportunity came about because they excel, mm-hmm. they excel, and they go to college. But sometimes that mentality never leaves, or it takes a while to leave. Mm-hmm. And I can speak from personal experience. When I left Memphis,
yeah,
and went to Louisiana, went to school, mm-hmm. man, look, the Memphis mentality was still in me.
Uh-huh.
It was still, that was still really, really rough around the edges. But one thing I did know was my grandfather wanted me to go to college, so I'm here.
Mm-hmm.
My homeboys wanted me to get out the neighborhood, so I'm here. That's it. I went to college on a music scholarship. I played trombone. It was in the band at Southern University, Human Jukebox. as far as sports and violence, man, look, sports can take a lot of people out of those situations, but it takes time. And we really don't have a bunch of systems to make that transition, because when you go, like the NCAA is a multi-million-dollar industry.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody gets paid. Mm-hmm. Coaches can switch and leave when they want to. Mm-hmm. But guess who does not get paid? The student athlete, the so-called student athlete.
The one that's making this machine go.
Making this system go. Man, let me try to make this parallel. Doesn't that sound a lot like slavery?
Mm-hmm.
Slavery was America's first multi-million, maybe multi-billion dollar industry, because mm-hmm. a bunch of people had to get paid, just like in the NCAA. Look, if I was living in Tennessee, and the slaves came in New Orleans, How did those slaves get to Tennessee? Somebody had to bring those slaves. Was it if they walk? Somebody got to feed them, make sure they're clean. Because if I buy a 6'4" slave, that's 250 pounds. I expect for him to be 6'4 and 250 when he gets to me.
Right.
I don't expect for him to be 6'4 and 210.
True.
He needs to be, so he got to be fed. They have to have medicine. They have to have water. These are all different jobs. Somebody got to make sure they don't run away. Well, arrested. All of these are different jobs. They have places to sleep. They can't be out in the elements in the rain. These are different jobs. This is a multi-million-dollar industry. But look at basketball, NCAA. It's people getting paid everywhere. TV contracts, shoe contracts, jerseys, coaches, trainers, everybody, facilities, everybody's getting paid except people who are making it go.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, so we talk about the sports and violence. Where is the system seeing people who are coming from some rough situations? Rough situations. Because they quit to get on you when you come from the situation and they're like, well, you're messing up this opportunity. Yeah, it's an opportunity, but 12 months ago, this person was playing basketball in high school and running throughout the hood, running amok.
Yeah.
No guidance.
Mm-hmm.
No father figures. People trying to hang on him because they see him as an opportunity.
Mm-hmm. To make some more money.
Where did the NCAA come in?
Yeah,
but where did the NCAA come in? Like we give a whole bunch of props to the places, the coaches like Coach K, who does a wonderful job as far as mentoring young men. At the same time, man, Coach K wouldn't be Coach K if he didn't have the players to make him Coach K.
That's true. Let me ask you this, Bryan. And this is a very, like, wide open, open-ended question.
Okay.
But why do things like this happen to black people?
Man, look, Ruben, we started from the back. Mm-hmm. Like, all this stuff is paperwork. Like, think about even music. African Americans came up with multiple forms of music. But who controls the music? Who owns the masters of all those forms of music? Who ended up getting all the credit for all them forms of music? This is not a new thing. It's just something else that's being taken from us because we behind. Like we were playing music, and then we were told to sign contracts. We didn't know that our stuff was being signed over. Why doesn't anyone think the fact that started off late? And when I say late, people had schools going on, and we still was in slavery.
Mm-hmm.
People had schools, get higher degrees, and it's illegal for us to read a book. We have schools and think tanks going on, and if you see too many African-Americans together in a group, you start either you kill them or you whip them.
Mm-hmm.
So we start a couple hundred years behind, but everybody expects us to be on par with everybody else. Like, but there's we was promised 40 acres of the mule to make up for those reparations, but we never received it. We were given the Freedmen's Bureau, but the funds got kind of funny with that organization that was supposed to help in the transition from slavery to through Reconstruction.
Tell me this. I'm sorry to cut you off, but minus reparations, how do you think we can evolve? Do you think there's some type of reconnection that we need to go through as far as African Americans go?
You know, man, I was listening. I do. And let me say this. Let me give you credit because he brought an interesting point that I never thought about. Dr. Umar Johnson said this, man. Look, when Africa, we don't have a connection to Africa.
Mm-hmm.
Think about if a bunch of Chinese people were being killed at the rate that African Americans are being killed and being publicized as African Americans are being publicized as they're being killed. Do you think China would have something to say about it?
Yeah, definitely
so. I believe
so.
Mm-hmm. I believe China would make a phone call like, look, we're supposed to be trade partners, but why is it that these young Chinese men and women are being killed in the streets? We need to have a cease, or this money flowing between us is going to cease. But we don't have the type of backing. So when you kill an African American, you have these few voices that pop up. You have your Al Sharpton, you have the African American, but we don't have the power of a nation. The Chinese have that backing. China is a nation, a powerful nation, a superpower in the world. But we don't have the backing of our country for a couple of reasons. We were cut off from them. We don't know our culture. We don't know our language. We don't know our traditions. We are Africans in mostly name. So we don't have that backing. So it's a really big disconnect. But if we had that backing, like Dr. Umar said, the things that would happen to us would be different. Because with Africa being one of the largest exporters of diamonds, it's actually the largest continent, or the largest continent, but has the most natural resources of any area in the world.
Mm-hmm.
I think the conversation would be a whole lot different if African Americans were being shot and Africa made a phone call.
Mm-hmm.
If Africa was, you know, we had that connection. So is there a way for us to connect and get out of the situation we're in? I absolutely do believe it, but it's going to take a lot. It's going to take education. It's going to take economics. It's going to take plans. And it's not going to be one great plan that all of the African Americans sit down and we come up with. We have to realize
it's work.
It's work. And we have to realize not just mediocre. Mediocre is not the bar. You cannot be mediocre because back in the day, our grandfathers and our grandmothers told us what I think Papa Pope on Scandal told his daughter, Olivia, you have to be twice as good to get half of what they got. That's you have to be twice as good. Think about this. You look at them old movies, Jackie Robinson. You look at all these old movies, and man, they wasn't slackers. They dealt with situations. They dealt with both sides of the situation. They had to go from the hood and deal with their black folks, but then they also had to jump on that other side of the coin. But what they didn't do, what never fostered, was their work ethic. Like, we get called lazy as African-Americans, but, man, like, how do we call lazy when we built the country? We built the first multi-million-dollar organization. We worked for a couple hundred years for free and didn't get anything.
Yeah, and then you got the dirt call us lazy. Yeah, that's crazy.
You call, like, while you was in the house, I was outside working 12, 13, 14 hours a day, 6-7 days a week. But for some reason or another, when I stopped doing that and asked you, by the time I get paid for the work I did, oh, you just too lazy. I said, really? Really, I'm lazy now. Look, greatness has to be there, but we have to start teaching our kids that stuff again. Man, look, you have to be, if you want to get out to the system, you got to be twice as good. Because you can't walk in there with the same resume as this person that's the opposite skin color of you and think you're going to get the job. Because that person, the people who own that company probably don't look like you just yet. We're working on it, but we're not quite there yet.
Tell me this, just to kind of wrap this thing up, Bryan. You're a teacher. You're a teacher of the year. What do you do in your classroom that is different from, I don't know, other teachers that you've had, teachers that you've, you know, shadowed? What do you do that's different?
Man, look, just to be honest with you, I think one of the worst classes I ever had was a history class. You might have been in the class.
Mm-hmm.
I think you might have been in that class at Whitehaven with me.
At Haverview or Whitehaven?
Whitehaven.
You know what? I think I was. Go ahead.
I'm gonna let the teacher name, you know, remain nameless. I'm gonna leave that alone.
Right.
But very, very, very horrible teacher. And I think I'm gonna attribute some of it. I think that might be her last year teaching, so she retired, she's going out the door. So, but it was a history class, and now I'm a history teacher. Horrible. She didn't put any effort into it, and it hurt me. My grandfather was a history teacher, and I know how. Like, we ride down the street, and he dropping history. I remember this. I remember there was no mall here. I remember when so-and-so lived here. I remember when these boys won the state track team track championship. I remember all these things. He just running this stuff down. When I'm in the classroom with my kids, we have conversations. I tell them about the stuff that's in his book, but I make it plain to them like they say in church. I make it plain to them, doctor. I give you what God love. I give you the truth. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to love on you. Like today, I got cursed out really, really, really bad by a young lady.
Wow.
I'm talking about she was going off. Mm. And when she finished going off and they came and gathered to calm down, guess what I told her?
What's that?
I love her. Because tomorrow, she's going to see me in the hallway and she's going to give me a hug. She's going to apologize. I know how it goes. Mm. Man, what I do differently in my classroom, I love when these kids and I love them hard. Mm. The person you got to get crazy, I still love them. I'm going to give you the truth. I'm going to give you all the tools that you're supposed to get in school. Mm. Because some of these tools you're not getting from your parents because they work multiple jobs. They're just not there. Or this person on the scene, or you being raised by your grandmother, it's a gap between you all two. You all don't see eye to eye. I'm going to be that gap. I'm going to feel that because I want to do that. I want to see you make it.
Yeah.
I believe in you. I believe in your success because like, I'm going to be old one day.
Yeah, you don't want to knock you over the head.
I don't want you knocking me over the head.
I worked in Murfreesboro City Schools for about 2 years, and that was like my thing. That's why I was like trying to be nice to all the kids, as many kids as possible. Because I was like, one day, y'all going to be the strong ones, and I'm going to be, you know, the fragile or frail dude. So I definitely want you guys hey, Mr. Rubin, hey, how you doing? Tell me this, Goose, in closing, what suggestions do you have for educators? Besides, you know, actually loving on the teacher, are there any other suggestions that you would give to a educator?
Absolutely. In my field, educators have taken a hit. All this nonsense in the news. These people doing all this stuff with these little kids and these little boys and little girls. Look, if you don't want to be an educator and you don't want to uplift my profession, get out.
Mm.
Don't tarnish my name. I'm third generation in it, and I'm serious about this. Get out. While you can, no hard feelings. Stop messing up these kids. Stop saying what you're going to do or using it as a placeholder for you to go somewhere else and do something else. Get out of my profession.
Right.
Leave leave my kids, either own my kids, leave them alone.
You got to have some heart out here.
Them? Absolutely. You want to educate them right? Get out. Room. I didn't home visits. Mm-hmm. I done did that. I show up at basketball games. I show up at cheerleading contests. I done was a majorette. I done bought clothes, like things that teachers do. I'm not saying it like I'm special. This is what we do. This is what we do on the record. We don't get paid a whole lot. Mm-hmm. And a lot of our money, we end up spending back on the kids. Mm-hmm. We try to get a really good product. And sometimes what we get is not what we want, not up to our standards. So we have to take our time, our money, our resources, and build up this product that we were given. To try to make it what we feel like it should be and what it can be.
That's the true investment of the future.
Absolutely. We're doing it, man. Teachers, everyone has a great teacher that they remember. Whether it's your coach or whatever, that's a teacher. Your first teacher is your mama. When you're in your womb, you're being taught already.
Hey, Goose, we're strapped by time constraints, man. I definitely did not get to all my questions. I still want to talk to you and hear your side of what do you think about the prison industrial complex and the reevaluation of who is winning and who is losing. Also, the president, this is 2016 and, you know, presidential race is going on. So I want to hear about all that. So
man. How
about this? How about you come back and do a solo Saturday with me and we're going to really get into it. We're going to have a whole hour.
That sounds absolutely wonderful, brother.
Hey, once again, man, I appreciate you for being here, dude.
I appreciate the opportunity. I love the show, man. You're doing great stuff. And keep doing what you're doing, baby. It's a wonderful thing.
Hey, I'm going to do that. This is Surround Sound Podcast. I am R. Hunter Jr. Once again, big thanks to my man, Bryan Goose Big Wilson. We'll be back next week, y'all.